and Tim, thank you very much. Well, it's lovely to be here, and thank you very much to the trustees and, of course, to Francis for the invitation to be here. And Francis, especially to you, actually, for organising the conference, the way you've gathered us together. But actually, I've just been really touched by the care that you've taken in the correspondence with us. So huge thanks for all your work. I'm really looking forward to the rest of the weekend, to catching up with good friends and with family. You've all met them, meeting some new friends. I'm also looking forward, of course, to hearing some excellent research and being part of some excellent discussion. I'm delighted to be given the 2018 Edward Bailey Memorial Lecture. I was lucky enough to meet Edward a few times at various conferences on that conference circuit that we're all part of. He was always warm and always incredibly generous, especially to younger scholars, and it's an honour to be with you today at such an esteemed event. I don't mind admitting that public lectures and keynotes are really very tricky things, mainly because for once I'm not just in a cosy room with my usual tribe of friends and colleagues, although some of them are here, working in my specific discipline, and also because an invitation to be a keynote on such an occasion as this sort of makes me feel like a proper grown-up academic. I'm not quite sure what to do. Today's presentation draws on my qualitative work, which explores Christian women's choices towards motherhood and voluntary childlessness. I'm currently preparing this material for a forthcoming book. So I'm at the stage where I kind of know what I want to say and the order that I want to say it in, and I've got a book proposal to prove it, but I don't always know the nitty-gritty steps and stages that I'm going to take to get there. So today is work in progress, and I'll be very grateful for questions and feedback. I'll start by saying that childlessness, family, children are difficult subjects to raise and research. In the past, sometimes my papers have provoked emotional and sometimes painful responses from audience members for many different reasons. So just to say, please do speak to me afterwards if there is anything that you'd like to discuss, and I can also point you in the direction of appropriate support if that is helpful. So to give you an overview of how we're going to spend the next 45 minutes or so, I'll first introduce the project by naming the key questions that have driven it and highlighting some of the puzzles that have prompted me to begin this research journey. Namely, the relationship between motherhood and the study of religion, which I'm going to suggest is actually kind of motherhood is neglected in religious studies, sociology, religion and parenting studies. I'll outline the different meanings of childlessness and give you some definitions there, and then also suggest actually that if we don't know very much about motherhood, we know even less about childlessness in Christianity. I'll briefly outline the methodology and method. I'm a qualitative researcher, we're supposed to do that. And then I'll explain what I've previously identified as the maternal expectation that runs through the Christian context in which my participants are navigating their choices. And I'll share some of the ways in which the women experience the maternal expectation and the difference it makes to their faith lives. Finally, I'll explore how participants understand choice and draw attention to two key ways that participants narrate choice, accidental and as a vocation. So I began this research in 2011 to explore how Christian women understand their reproductive choices to have children or remain child-free, when they're part of an institution where the dominant message is that women should have children. And then how they navigate this religious expectation, or put it more strongly, obligation to have children, when, as Diana Myers has suggested, there is a voluntarist rhetoric regarding women's reproductive choices towards motherhood, and more women generally in the West are choosing not to become mothers. What factors might feature in their decision-making? What kind of influences are shaping that decision-making process? How do they interpret the normative messages that are enshrined in scripture, doctrine and teaching, and everyday church practice? And then what impact can these choices have on their religious gendered identities? So these questions are prompted by several key issues in the study of gender and Christianity. Motherhood is given an awful lot of prominence in Christianity. It's visibly there in iconography, in metaphor, in imagery. It's there in exposition and commentary on teachings from doctrine and practices. And yet relatively little attention has been given to how Christianity's construction of motherhood impacts the faith lives of lay women. Or to put it another way, as I've argued elsewhere, there's an academic maternal silence that means we know very little about the social and cultural positions women are given in regard to the maternal. And this neglect is a little bit odd. We know from various qualitative studies in feminism and religion that motherhood is a key factor in women's faith and spiritual lives. Fuller and Fast have discussed this in terms of Mennonite mothering. Halbert Howe did a beautiful qualitative piece of work where she compares Catholic feminist women's experiences of parenting with Jewish Orthodox women's experiences of parenting and understands how feminism shaped their attitude to raising their daughters. And Nicholas Slee's work on women's faith development highlights very briefly that women often name motherhood as a key site of spiritual awareness and awakening. But most of the focus in women's in feminist religious studies has been in challenging the patriarchal structures that produce unfeasible representations of motherhood. Think of Eve's association with punishment and the agony of childbirth, or the veneration of the Virgin Mary's perfect, pure passiveness. Feminist theologians and religious studies scholars have deconstructed and reconstructed mothering stereotypes to offset patriarchal language, theology, and metaphor. And this is incredibly important work, but I have to agree with Sarah Jane Page when she argues that studies on mothers and faith involvement are lacking and more research is needed on how such identities are pursued. Now, this absence is predictable. Women's experiences are generally neglected within the study of religion. But motherhood in particular, according to Clarissa Atkinson, who's a historian, has a slightly awkward place. She said motherhood has no history because, she argues, it is too thoroughly identified with the private sphere and with the changeless biological aspects of the human condition. In the late 20th century, there has been a growing scholarship in maternal studies and parenting studies, but it's very difficult to find any reference to religion in that body of work at all. Motherhood also holds quite an odd place in the sociology of religion, particularly regarding gender and secularisation, the process through which religion is losing influence in the public and the private sphere. On the one hand, women outnumber men by approximately 2-1 in their adherence and active participation in Christianity and in post-traditional religion like feminist spiritualities, contemporary paganism, or activities and practices that are associated with the holistic milieu. And the reason for this has often been linked to women's proximity to pregnancy, birth, and motherhood. Important life events and transitions that, according to Grace Davey, Linda Woodhead, Bruce and Chesletowska, that they correspond, those moments, those life-changing moments, correspond with a religious orientation. So women are well placed socially to be closer to a religious kind of dimension. On the other hand, shifting gender norms are thought to contribute to secularisation. The changes pertaining to women's work, equitable sexual relationships, being entitled to make choices about having children that began in the 50s and the 60s with the Cultural Revolution and the arrival of easily accessible contraception mean that women are questioning and rejecting the authoritative structures like the church that restrict their agency. And as a result, they leave the church. And when they do, according to Cameron Brown, Kristen Ohner et al., they take their partners and their family with them. So this is part of the context in which women are navigating their reproductive agency in Christianity. I think these almost competing conditions are, at the very least, suggestive that the processes through which women become or do not become mothers and carers of children is a deeply significant and important site through which to understand how women make sense of their gendered religious identities. So, as I suggested, if we don't know very much about motherhood and women's experiences of motherhood, we know even less about childlessness. Childlessness is usually characterised in three ways. Involuntary childlessness includes a range of experiences, such as infertility, which the World Health Organization defines as a disease of the reproductive system defined by the failure to achieve a clinical pregnancy after 12 months or more of regular unprotected sexual intercourse. It's a very clinical definition, very medical model definition. Secondary infertility occurs when infertility follows a previous live pregnancy or successful conception. And these terms are currently under review by the World Health Organization, precisely for that reason that I suggested, because it only includes medical reasons. When there are other reasons for childlessness that's often called social childlessness or childlessness by circumstance. And these cover situations where individual, cultural or legal structures prevent or hinder conception or birth. Think about how poverty can impact health and therefore reduce conception and live birth. Same-sex couples in some societies are denied access to adoption or reproductive technologies. Being single involuntarily might reduce the options for becoming a parent. Or when one partner in a relationship wants a child but the other doesn't. Caring for others reduces the likelihood of having children. Early menopause or other illnesses unrelated to fertility, such as mental health or recovery from addiction. More of those circumstances can potentially reduce the likelihood that conception might not occur. Voluntary childlessness is the active, positive decision not to have children. And this is sometimes referred to as being child-free, elective childlessness, non-motherhood, intentional childlessness, or childlessness by choice. They're often used interchangeably. So for some context, it's helpful to think about some of the data on birth rates and childlessness. And in Europe, birth rates are falling. You might have seen this statistic from the Office for National Statistics. It's the one that's often kind of repeated in media articles on childlessness, particularly if there's going to be a moral panic about the fact that women are giving birth less. So 1 in 9 women born in England and Wales in 1940 were childless at the age of 45, and you see that that's increased to 1 in 5 women born in England and Wales in 1967 were childless at the age of 45. Statistics do vary, but generally childlessness amongst 18 to 50s is estimated to range between 15 and 25%. I'm not a sociologist, I am just stealing the stats that are out there, okay? So you can't ask me mean questions about where this information comes from. The stats don't differentiate between different kinds of childlessness, but the sociologist Renske Kaitzer has taken a life course perspective to examine how decisions towards childlessness are shaped by past experiences and then how that choice impacts life outcomes. She examined men and women's choices in the Netherlands, and she suggests that out of her research cohort, and then she's extrapolated it to the Dutch context, that approximately 10% of those who are childless by choice, 10% through infertility, and 80% through circumstance. So that broad category of social childlessness that I mentioned earlier. It's difficult to say whether these trends will continue. Very recently, the research body Pew has released this figure for the UK. In 2006, 80% of women aged between 40 and 44 have become mothers, and that's increased to 86% in 2018. In the scholarship, there are various reasons for voluntary childlessness. Gearson talks about the fact that women are more active in the workplace, and therefore that's creating different kinds of decisions around delaying motherhood or not becoming a mother at all. Park mentions that it's most likely just down to a kind of lack of a maternal instinct. The Viz, I don't know how you say her name, she's a Canadian sociologist. But this work, she's one of the earliest to kind of take the trends on childlessness seriously as a voluntary mode of decision making. And she says that one of the things that she noticed that couples who decide to not have children tend to be quite worried that it's going to detract or pull away from the happiness they envisage their life to have. Shapiro highlights that it's the emphasis on freedom and autonomy for women, that sense of entitlement that I mentioned, that we've inherited from the 50s and the 60s. And Callister and Clark, they say, well, age differences between partners amongst couples who don't have children is a very significant factor. So despite this kind of work, and the space given in sociological, feminist, and women's studies work about voluntary childlessness, religion is barely mentioned. Now, in part, this is because affiliation to religion normally decreases the likelihood of voluntary childlessness. So, for instance, in Catholicism, if you're active in Catholicism, decreases the likelihood of elective childlessness by about 37% in men and about 35% in women, if all other variables stay the same. So I've not come across any work so far, and please tell me if you know of any, that has looked at voluntary childlessness qualitatively from a faith perspective. There's one study by O'Mahony, who's a doctoral candidate in the Republic of Ireland, and she's looking at the stigmatised experiences of childless women in that context. And she acknowledges that yes, Catholicism is enmeshed in the context in which her participants are living, but she doesn't focus on faith at all, not on practice, not on belief. So to try and fill in some of these gaps, I undertook two stages of qualitative work between 2011 and 2013. First, through personal contacts, I invited four women to a group interview. I used narrative in-depth interviews with 18 participants, and three of them had also taken part in the group interview. Recruitment was through snowball sampling and via networks and social media. So women self-selected to take part. And this is appropriate because this is sensitive and intrusive research. You can't assume a maternal identity just by a perceived or apparent absence or presence of children in somebody's life. And therefore this meant I also followed their phrasing of how they identified as a mother, stepmother, non-mother, voluntary childlessness, child-free. I also wanted to trouble the binary which features in maternal studies, and you'll have seen it played out in broader popular cultural discourses too, particularly on social media, that's created by the language of motherhood and non-motherhood, in which the latter, non-motherhood, positions childlessness negatively, defining women as what they are not in relation to the normative mother. This divides women too easily into two camps, the mums and the non-mums, assuming differences rather than commonalities. I do not want to collapse or generalise the experience of motherhood and childlessness together. I don't want to draw seamless parallels between infertility and childlessness by choice. And I do want to allow for the possibility that there are overlapping plural ways that Christian women conceive of motherhood and childlessness, and that there's the potential for these roles to coalesce within individual women and between women. So I managed to have a range of Christian identities: Anglican, Roman Catholic, Baptist, Methodist, United Reform, emerging church, evangelical, and some participants had quite a loose affiliation to Christianity, but nonetheless identified as Christian. The women were aged between 20 and 50. I wanted to capture different stages of life at when that decision might be happening, as well as retrospectively. And there was a range of sexual identities, relationships, employment, levels of class varied as well, although education was relatively high. There are, however, voices missing. Despite attempts to broaden the research by advertising explicitly in black minority and ethnic urban churches, only one participant identifies as a woman of colour. This lack of racial diversity requires challenge. I've challenged it myself in my own writings. But for the book, I do want to include the voices of women of colour, so please do let me know if this is of interest to you or to your networks. One of the shared experiences for the women in this study is that they are part of a faith community in which the family is a central social and moral structure. Despite the range of beliefs that comprise contemporary Christianity, its teachings, doctrine and church life can be characterised as pronatalist or natalist. The two terms are interchangeable. Women are at the heart of this ideology that promotes childbearing and parenting as the principal focus of one's life. And for women, it advocates motherhood as the ideal way to live out one's Christian life. Most societies and cultures can, to some extent, be described as pronatalist. You only have to look at the media coverage of the newborn royal baby to see how women are naturalised as mothers and carers of children. In Christianity, one of the ways this is expressed is, for example, through the Quiverful movement. A conservative, largely Protestant group based mostly in the US, They emphasise strongly the moral importance of a high birth rate because it contributes to the growing Christian population and to their evangelical mission. Following New Testament writings, such as the household codes in Ephesians, the Quiverful groups hold a patriarchal and anti-feminist worldview in which men are the head of the household and women and children are expected to obey their husbands and fathers. Quiverful Christians are inspired by the literal reading and interpretation of Psalm 127:3-5 to reject all forms of birth control. The verse reads, "Children are a heritage from the Lord, offspring a reward from him. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are children born in one's youth. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them." Rather than control reproduction naturally or artificially, Quiverful couples believe that God governs the number of times a woman conceives and gives birth. Young women usually marry before the age of 20, rather than continue with their education, and this is to increase the opportunities to have as many children as possible. Now, the Quiverful movement is a very explicit articulation of pronatalism. My women aren't operating in that kind of world, but it does highlight one way in which these discourses are present in the contemporary evangelical Christian movement. But they are, in my study, exposed to a very heavy maternal expectation that circulates their Christian lives. Or, as Adrienne Rich has captured in her oft-cited phrase, there is an institution of motherhood, a constructed patriarchal system that defines, restricts, and controls women's relationship to their reproductive agency. And this is visible in many different contexts. We could also add to this that parenting studies has noticed what they call an intensification of parenting. Parenting is just no longer something than the pre-modern era where you just raised your family. It's now a sense, it's now a kind of sight of self-fulfillment, of meaning-making, of value, of moral worth. Gordon Lynch has pointed to this, as has Anna Strahan. In Christianity, the maternal expectation is particularly evident in the ways that ideas about fertility and childbearing become attached to women's Christian identities. Here are just a few examples, no doubt they'll be very familiar to you. In scripture, declarations such as "be fruitful and multiply" in Genesis, and in 1 Timothy 2:15, the statement that women will be saved through childbirth. These are often drawn upon to suggest that having biological children within marriage is the realisation of a woman's faith identity. In Roman Catholic teaching, motherhood is described in Evangelium Vitae as the fundamental contribution that the church and humanity can expect from women. In two separate occasions, in 2014 and 2015, Pope Francis chastised married couples who are delaying or choosing not to have children for their selfishness and their selfish act of not having children, because their focus is too much on holidays, on pets, and on well-being culture. This is a sentiment that was echoed in the Synod to the Family and its subsequent 2016 Apostolic Exhortation, The Joy of Love, in which Pope Francis, in response to a concern about dropping birth rates, writes about his worries about people who lack a mentality of an openness to life, and writes that industrialization, the sexual revolution, the fear of overpopulation and economic problems, consumerism, may also deter people from having children simply so they can maintain a certain freedom and lifestyle. And it's the simply there that signals the criticism. I've already mentioned that religious feminists have challenged Mary's valorization. She may well signal the feminine divine in a tradition otherwise depleted of the sacred feminine. She might well act as a symbol of solidarity with mothers. She is the most, though, as Kristeva has argued, reified, symbolic construction of the maternal, and her perfection is impossible to emulate. She sacralises motherhood. Ritual and social practices also illustrate the ideology of motherhood or parenting. Marriage services that mention the nurturance of children, Mother's Day, family barbecues, Sunday schools, messy church, the Mother's Union, standing outside church with children when you don't have them, are all very visible spaces where motherhood is idealised and privileged. Now, I know and you know that historically there are places in tradition where Christianity does not depend on family, and Christian identity actually might be not fulfilled through the family. I'm thinking of the New Testament writings where Jesus rejects family life, and in some of the early martyr narratives, such as the 3rd century text, The Passion of Perpetua and Felicity, in which Perpetua's status as a mother is secondary to her desire to die a martyr, the ultimate recognition of Christian identity. But despite those glimpses of alternatives, the normative message for lay women is that they are supposed to be mothers, and their Christian identities are fulfilled by becoming mothers. For many of the women in this study, mothers and the voluntary childless women, they experience the maternal expectation in ways that do not fulfil their Christian identity, but instead can hinder and limit the outworking of their faith. Sam is an Anglican priest and is in a long-term relationship with her female partner. In the interview, she comments, "Too many people worship at the altar of must-have children." This is witty, and it's suggestive of the excessive sacred meaning given to motherhood. Sam also remarks that she's quite used to that knowing look that she comes across in Christian circles where, well, if you're a nice woman under the age of 40, you're bound to have a baby any minute now, aren't you? Her personal vision of church and God is inclusive. She finds it, though, she says, really distressing that the institution in which she works and ministers and worships considers her queer identity and her voluntary childlessness to run counter to its set of rules. These are her words. Crucially, it also prohibits her from living out her faith life. She says, it's difficult to work under the authority of an institution that says, when you believe that God says, you are who you are and I want you to blossom and be all that I've made you to become. That's a tense balance, she says. Rebecca is 35, a Roman Catholic with two children. She talks incredibly movingly about how her children bring grace to her life. But she no longer has the emotional or physical space, she says, to feel grounded as a woman before God. She contrasts the spiritual life and practice she had before children, including yoga, Ignatian spirituality, volunteering. She contrasts that with her life now and says at that moment that spiritual life has never really come back since having the babies. She says this is because motherhood demands, I quote, a sacrifice of my own creativity at this point and potentially quite a long time. This is in part because of the perfect, selfless ways that motherhood is presented. Remember, she's in a Catholic context, particularly through the romanticised figure of Mary. She says, I feel like Mary is just trying to make up something where it doesn't exist. Okay, Mary probably did do quite a lot of housework, and I'm sure she was quite a strong woman, but that's not the tradition that we've received, is it? The maternal expectation means that, she says, not a lot of truth is told about what motherhood actually involves, because it is a model that values selflessness. And she says, an idea of sacrificing the self before the self has even been given what it needs, that's often at the heart of what the church makes of motherhood. It's valued, but it's a false paradigm. The parish and her weekly worship are places where Rebecca is supposed to feel nourished. It's supposed to be a space in which she can raise these concerns. But the idealisation and essentialist presentation of motherhood through Mary for her means she finds it impossible to acknowledge her struggles, to admit that motherhood is messy, complex, to admit that it's detracting from the spiritual life she felt she once had, and this prevents her spiritual life from flourishing. For the participants in this study, the maternal expectation can make some church spaces unwelcome. For example, Mothering Sunday can be a highly charged time, and the celebration of motherhood can cause painful moments of exclusion. Elizabeth attends an Anglican cathedral. She says Mother's Day is just one of the worst times of the year, and she self-excludes from going to church on that day. Actually, quite a lot of my participants self-exclude from church on Mothering Sunday. Lots of reasons. Elizabeth exemplifies that the orientation towards motherhood is very fluid. She identifies as a non-mother, but says, but I am also a stepmother to her ex-husband's daughter, and she's still an active participant in that young woman's